Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the School of Global Policy and Strategy. I'm Peter Cowie, and I have the privilege to serve as the dean of the school. They tell me the mic is working. All right, here we go. Thank you. So at the School of Global Policy and Strategy, we both deal with issues that are truly global, but we also deal, in a sense, with the particular of the key regions that this school was built around, of Asia and the Americas. As part of that focus of the school, we resolved years ago to build the preeminent center on China in the United States. And out of that vision has emerged the Center on 21st Century China, which is the organizer of this program, and this is one of its two key events of the year. This is the Ellsworth Lecture for reasons that are important to understanding both the history of the school and of the center. Robert Ellsworth was a distinguished statesman in the finest tradition of American politics and policy. He was a congressman, he was a war veteran, he was a person who was a special assistant to the president. He went on to be the ambassador to NATO, and he was deputy secretary of defense. In later years, he moved to San Diego and became deeply involved in this school as a member of our international advisory board. And in that role, he was an unrelenting advocate in the most gentle but persistent way that if we were to be a school truly built around our concern about the Pacific, we had to be a leader on China, and we should just take the steps of investment and work to make that into a reality. And so this lecture is very much a symbol of how you as a community help shape the agenda of an institution like UCSD and the School of Global Policy and Strategy. And we're lucky today that with the leadership of that center, we've achieved Bob Ellsworth's dream for the school. Now, you'll hear more about this later on, but I would like to have the opportunity now to have you share in getting to know somebody who is Bob's partner in helping spread the spirit at the school, the Reverend Eleanor Ellsworth. Eleanor.
It's my honor to be able to welcome everyone here today. And I think you characterized perfectly and beautifully what Bob's hope and vision and support for the school was all about. The fact that this memorial lecture continues to occur really speaks to the people who make it happen. And I want to give special thanks to you, Dean Cowie, to Professor Shirk, to Susan Shirk, and to Lei Guang. Where are you, Lei? Right there. Because without you all and the team supporting all of you, this simply wouldn't happen. There's another thing that I'd simply like to say, and that is, although Professor Madsen is going to actually introduce you, Ian, I want to say how happy I am that you are here. What a joy it is to read your book, Souls of China. So I'm going to unabashedly say, if you haven't read it, I recommend and commend it, because in it you get to know the soul and the culture and the heart of the people of China. Thank you, Ian. Look forward to your talk. Now, Dick, wherever you are, Professor Madsen.
Well, it's a great joy to, first of all, see so many people from the community here tonight, and with your interest in China and engagement in this lecture series. So we really depend on so much on your support, and it's very, very heartening to see you all here. And it's a tremendous pleasure for me to introduce to you Ian Johnson, who is, I believe, the finest journalist around today who is studying China. Ian has been engaged with the Chinese societies, the Greater China World, for at least 20 years. He currently resides mostly in Beijing, where he is at the so-called Beijing Center, which is actually a center established by the Jesuits to facilitate education abroad programs. And it's fitting because the Jesuits under Matteo Ricci and these great missionaries were so interested in kind of engaging with Chinese culture, understanding in its own terms and so forth. And in a certain sense, he resonates with that kind of mission and has helped to carry it out. So Ian has won the Pulitzer Prize for his reporting from China, especially about the Falun Gong movement, but other things in year 2001. And he's won many, many other awards. I think most recently, the Shorenson Award from Stanford University for distinguished journalism on Asia. And I won't go through all the other awards that he's won. He has a special knack for not just being an excellent journalist, but an outstanding one. And an excellent journalist, I think, listens very carefully to his sources and reports on them faithfully and describes them in vivid, memorable language. And Ian does that. But then he goes beyond that, and he is a way of putting into context, into historical, sociological, political context, the kind of things that he learns. And it's rare for a journalist these days to go so deep into a particular culture and a particular society, and then to write about it in such an elegant way. His latest book is called The Souls of Modern China, and it's about this extraordinary religious revival that has happened in China, something that caught by surprise, I think, intellectuals, social scientists, and others in the West, indeed, as well as in China. And he explores how this is going on and gives suggestions about where it's leading China in the future. So it's a beautiful book, a very exciting book. I urge you, as Eleanor did, to go out and get it. There'll be some for sale, and I think in the lobby afterwards. It's a wonderful book, and it's going to have a broad public resonance, and also a wonderful book to use in courses and so forth. So, with that, let me welcome Ian Johnson.
Thank you. So I'm especially excited now to stand up because I can move off that slide of me, which is has been irritating me for the past half hour. Oh yeah, you're right. Yeah, okay, I'll turn that off. Yeah, so I am, yeah, good, thanks. So I'd like to, yeah, talk a little bit about China's religious revival and why it matters and so on and so forth. Behind me are pictures of religious life in China. They're not timed exactly to my talk, but they're meant as a backdrop to give you some idea of what it looks like in China if you haven't been there. But in fact, this particular slide isn't a good way to start because this is something, you know, we might see if you go to a temple in China, a person holding a what brand is that? Is that a Gucci? Right. Sorry, a Gucci. Right. I was going to say Coach. I always mix these things up. I don't know how do I mix that. And so there's several noteworthy things about the picture. One is that it's probably a real Gucci bag, whereas 10 or 20 years ago it would have been a fake Gucci bag. And also all the people in there. And this is something that we take for granted if we go to a temple or a church or a mosque in China today, but it wasn't something that was obvious or that you would have seen back when I went to China for the first time, which was 1984. I went there as a student. I was at Peking University, and I was interested in religious life. I grew up in a fairly religious household, and I wondered what religious life was like in China. Of course, I had some ideas. I'd read some books on Buddhism and the Tao Te Ching by Lao Tzu and so on and so forth. But I wondered what, these were all sort of ancient books, and I knew there was Christianity and Islam, but I wondered what had survived. Don't forget, 1984 was just 8 years after the end of the Cultural Revolution, when Mao died. And I thought, you know, was curious to see if anything sort of had survived. I remember we were at Beijing University, and friends of mine, we would ride our bicycles out to look at different temples and churches and so on and so forth. And I went down with a group of friends on our cast iron flying pigeon bicycles, one gear. I guess they're called fixed gear bicycles nowadays, but no, it's actually different. And we rode down to the White Cloud Temple, which is the headquarters of the Taoist Association, China's indigenous religion, Taoism. We went there, took an hour or so to bicycle down there. Of course, now there's cars and so on and so forth, and you can get stuck in a traffic jam, and it'll still take you an hour to get there. But back then, so we rode our bicycles all the way down there, and the temple was actually quite well preserved, despite all the destruction of the Cultural Revolution, but it was pretty empty. There was nothing like this. We saw a few Taoists scurrying around, and I guess we were the only other people who were there on that weekday, or maybe it was a weekend. I can't remember. And after other visits like that to other places of worship, I left China in 1985 thinking that religious life seemed to be, if not dead, it was at least almost irrelevant. And the places of worship seemed like these sort of typical places you might find in a communist country that had been preserved as museums to some sort of a sociological phenomenon called religion that communism had successfully eradicated or left behind on its march toward progress. I mean, at that time in Beijing, you have to think there was one, this is Beijing then, now it has 20 odd million people, but back then it still had about 8 million. There was one mosque, there was a couple of churches, a couple of Buddhist temples, one Taoist temple, probably fewer than, all told, fewer than a dozen places of worship for this enormous city. And they did feel like museum pieces by and large. So I left thinking that religion was not important at all in China. And I was wrong on a couple of counts. One reason I was wrong was that religion was actually reviving at that time, but me being a newbie to China and not realizing everything that I was seeing, I didn't quite get it. But I was also wrong on another level, which is, I think, interesting and worth exploring a little more, and that is that I had attributed all of this to the 30 years of communism, starting in 1949 with the communist takeover, and at that point, especially the radical phase with Mao Zedong ending with his death in 76, and I thought, well, this is typical for what would happen under communism. The communists are atheists, and so they attack religion. And that wasn't incorrect, but that was not even really the primary reason for the desolate state of religious life in China at that time. In fact, I think to understand what had happened in China and what we're experiencing now, you have to go back to the late 19th century, or the mid-19th century, when China was going through this incredibly traumatic period in its history in the wake of the Opium Wars and a series of defeats, one after another, that left people extremely insecure about their own traditions, their own political system, their culture, their religion. And of course, initially when China suffered these defeats, they thought this is just maybe sort of bad luck, or we just need some better weapon systems and things like that. But one defeat followed the other. And by the late 19th century, people were thinking we don't just need to have some sort of a better government in China or a change the emperor. We need to get rid of all of this, including and especially religion. And you may think, well, why religion? Why is religion so important? Couldn't China have simply changed out its political system, modernized its economic structure, and kept its religious life? Especially nowadays when you see religion back in China, and China being an economic superpower, there seems to be no contradiction between Chinese religion and sort of a modern economy, for example. But in the 19th century, as in many traditional societies around the world, politics and religion were closely intertwined. They were inseparable, in fact. And it's more useful to think of China being run than by a political religious system, with the emperor, sort of demigod at the top, the officials who were loyal to him, who were sent out to rule the empire, were legitimated through quasi-religious rituals. And maybe more than that, the officials, the mandarins who ran the empire, didn't penetrate deep down into Chinese society. This wasn't a modern bureaucratic state. This was a state that had, yes, these officials, but they oversaw thousands of people. And on a daily basis, society was run by a gentry or literati who were kind of sort of independent of the government. And their lives were centered around and defined by religious rituals and religious practices. The historian, sociologist Prasenjit Duara has a wonderful term for this, calling temples in China the nexus of power in traditional society. You have to think that the temple life was, the people who ran the temples were often the same people who might build the irrigation canals or build the roads or raise a militia against bandits. So religion and politics were hard to separate. And when reformers in the late 19th century, when they were trying to change China, they had to attack the center of power. That included religion. It was impossible to separate the two. And so you have these very interesting examples. For example, the great reformer Kang Youwei in the late 19th century, 1898, there were the 100 Days of Reforms. One of his ideas was to convert temples into schools. The idea that China needed education and needed a modern, educated citizenry, it didn't need all of these temples. Or the revolutionary Sun Yat-sen, who's credited with overthrowing the Qing dynasty in 1911. One of his first acts of rebellion as a young man before leaving Guangdong province where he grew up was to go to the local Taoist temple with a stick and smash the statue of the deity. The idea that this was all the stuff we need to get rid of. We need to get rid of all of this backward, superstitious stuff that's holding China back from progress. So by the time the nationalists take power in China, shortly after the overturn of the revolution, religion is seen as a social ill. Traditional Chinese religion is seen as a social ill, analogous maybe, or on a par with foot binding and concubinage, illiteracy, that sort of thing. It was a problem that had to be dealt with. The nationalists issued a law in the early 1930s about which temples should be destroyed and which temples should be preserved. And by and large, most temples did not pass muster and were slated, or were, in the officials' minds, were sort of slated for destruction. The paradigm that they used to judge proper religious life, because people saw that there was religion in Western countries and Western countries were strong, but the paradigm was some religions are okay, but there are other religions which are superstitious. And this binary view of spiritual life in China took hold then, and up until very recently defined how most religions were seen by the state. And the norm for what an appropriate religion was by and large Christianity. So it would be a religion that had a clergy, a professional clergy meeting at a certain place with a certain sort of body of holy scriptures, books, and it would not be the kind of folk practices that actually dominated Chinese religious life. Because we think nowadays of Chinese religion being defined, say, you have Taoism, you have Buddhism, but actually, for most of Chinese society, these were not meaningful distinctions. There were some places that were purely Buddhist and purely Taoist, but probably 95% of religious life in China was an amalgam, a syncretic mixture of these two. And so a lot of these did not have a professional clergy, and many were then destroyed. There are rough numbers that give you an idea. The French historian Vincent Gossard thinks roughly at the end of the 19th century there were about 1 million temples in China, which is probably an undercounting because China must have had about 800,000 villages around then, and many, many villages had multiple temples. So there were probably well over 1 million temples. But the main point that his estimate is that by the middle of the 20th century, half of them had been destroyed or repurposed. Government offices, schools, many of the most famous schools in China today, public schools, are built on the grounds of former temples. So there was this enormous wave of auto-cultural genocide, essentially, that went on through the 20th century, predating the communists. So when the communists took over, they were just following in the footsteps of what elites in China had thought was a major social problem. Now, obviously, the communists were much stronger. They had a much more effective, brutal government that carried this through much more thoroughly than, say, the nationalists had been able to do in their period in power before, of course, Japan invaded and so on and so forth. So the communists, the same as the nationalists, they defined five religious groups in China, which are still today the five official religions in China. That would be China's indigenous religion, Taoism, Buddhism, Islam, and then for administrative purposes in China, Christianity is split in two, Catholicism and Protestantism. So these are the five official religious groups in China. Some people may ask, what about Confucianism? Isn't that a religion, or shouldn't that have been a religion? There's some Confucian scholars in the audience who are smiling. This is an old, so there were some reformers like Kang Youwei in the late 19th, early 20th century, who thought that all countries need to have a national religion. And Japan had created a religion, essentially Shintoism, in the 19th century, so shouldn't China do the same with Confucianism? But I think Confucianism was too closely aligned with the Ancien regime that it didn't make it. So even in the 20s and 30s, it was not defined as, it didn't make it as a religious group in China, and the communists didn't accept it either. So this policy then continues under the communists. They have these five official religions, only lasts for a few years. By the late 1950s, China's lurching ever more toward radical policies under Mao, culminating in the Cultural Revolution, when all open practice of religious life is essentially banned. All temples, mosques, churches are closed. There are, you know, many examples of different clergy from different religious organizations, different religions, Buddhism, Catholicism, Taoism, who had taken vows of chastity, who were forced to marry. The great cathedral in Taiyuan was turned into a living exhibition where priests and nuns had to sort of stand in cages, and 600,000 people filed through the cathedral just to look at this sort of freak show of stuff that we are finally sort of getting rid of. So, and it was replaced, if by anything, with Mao as a quasi-god. The sun rising in the east, the little red book of Mao's quotations being a sort of holy book that people waved around, and so on and so forth. Now, the problem with Mao as a god is, of course, that he died. It sort of doesn't help your claim to deification. Well, good, depends what happens afterwards. But he hasn't risen from the dead, at least, so he's still buried on Tiananmen Square in the mausoleum, which I can resist that. Anyways, which I have to say, to this day, I have never been to. I've lived in China now, added all together for almost 20 years, and I still find it just too weird. I just have not brought myself to go to it. But one of my students is researching necrophilia. Or, no, he's researching bodies, so he's a dead body, sacred relics, exactly. So we've taken him to a few places, and he wants to go to the Mao Memorial Hall, so I said, okay, I'll take you there. So we're planning to go when I get back to China next week. So that will, but anyway, so Mao died, and the party has a bit of a rethink. Don't forget, the first 30 years, almost the first 30 years of the party's control of China from 49 to the late 70s is a series of unmitigated disasters. The worst famine in recorded history, endless series of campaigns, wasted potential and talent that alienates, of course, a lot of the population. So there are various steps that are taken. We all know, of course, the economic reforms that Deng Xiaoping sort of unleashed in late 1978. Or at least that he kind of endorsed that were already happening on their own. And this led to economic growth and so on and so forth. But the party also made some gestures to society. And one of them was to stop the direct persecution, or to try to at least tone down the direct persecution of religion. Starting in 1982, it issued a very important document, Document 19, that essentially said, the first 30 years of our rule, we took the wrong policy toward religion. Religion is going to go away, of course. We know that as good communists, as we progress to socialism and communism, religion will just die away. But we don't need to beat people over the head, literally with a cudgel, and destroy it that way. Instead, we'll just take a more hands-off, laissez-faire approach. We'll allow some temples and churches and mosques to reopen. We'll allow new clergy to be trained. But we'll even explicitly allow house churches to meet. But we won't explicitly attack it. I think this was thought of as a kind of, sop to society. Let Granny Wong have her little temple that she can go to and light incense, and sooner or later, Granny Wong won't be with us anymore, and along with her generation, all of these people, religion will sort of go away. But what happened was kind of the opposite. Religion continued to grow. And when I got back to China in 1994, then as a newspaper correspondent, even I couldn't help miss the explosive growth of religion, which was obvious to anybody who went to a park in China at that time. There was a huge movement of Qigong fever, people called it. And Qigong is a neologism. It describes physical practices, sort of analogous perhaps to yoga. And in the parallel is kind of useful because just like some people practice yoga just for the health benefits and they do hot yoga and all this other kind of stuff, there are other people who practice yoga with a spiritual component, right? And it's the same with Qigong. Qigong has a spiritual side to it. It's moving the qi around in your body and some slow movements sometimes, or just meditation. There's different kinds of Qigong. Some people just did it for the health, but other people did it because they found a spiritual value in Qigong. And Qigong groups got better and better organized. Some of the groups began to write down tracts, pamphlets with moral advice to people. An anthropologist described Qigong as a release after the trauma of the Cultural Revolution. It was something done in public, in parks. So you had millions of people every morning out in the parks in China practicing Qigong, maybe just standing there like this, or hugging a tree and doing all other kinds of stuff like that. You thought, oh, California had a monopoly on tree huggers, but actually China had more, at least at one point. And this culminated with the Falun Gong movement, which was the best organized of these Qigong groups. Somebody called it, I think a nice term for it would be militant Qigong. They decided that the government, that the people weren't treating it with the correct amount of respect. And so in 1999, they made the ill-fated decision to go to downtown Beijing, right across from the leadership in Zhongnanhai, and have a giant sit-down strike. And when the party obviously reacted by banning Falun Gong, there was a brutal crackdown. But this was a sign that I think that you could see that, that people were concerned with spiritual issues. The Qigong movement was just a very obvious way. Also at that time, churches were exploding in number. There were mosques being built. Also at that time in the 1990s, a friend of mine, a very eccentric American businessman, who started a US registered charity called the Taoist Restoration Society. I thought this was a great, sounded great. It's like he wants to restore Taoism perhaps as the state religion of China. But that actually wasn't his term. He just wanted to restore Taoist temples, rebuild Taoist temples that had been destroyed. So I was working then for the Wall Street Journal, and he said to me, Ian, when you're traveling around China writing about China's accession to WTO and things like that, why don't you just see what the local Taoists are doing and what kind of temples are out there and which temples need my help? And so I said to my friend Brock, I said, yeah, sure, I'll do that. And I traveled around, and after a while, he made some donations to temples worth, you know, several tens of thousands of dollars. It wasn't insignificant. But I said, you know, really, this money that you're offering, it's kind of chump change in China nowadays. I mean, you go to the temples, even in the 90s, right? This, you can imagine what it's like now. Back then, these, you know, steles, these are stone slabs that have the donors' names carved on there and how much money they donated. You can add this together and you realize these temples are getting way more money than you can actually donate. As you could see that people were donating money, they were interested in religion, and it was reviving. So I left China again and then came back around the time of the Olympics, and what had seemed like a personal interest of mine in the 80s and maybe of somewhat importance in the 90s to me had become of central importance in China, to Chinese society. And this was a widespread perception, which persists today, of a spiritual vacuum in China, that decades of go-go economics have made people wealthier than ever, have satiated most people's material needs. Not all people, there's still poor people, but many people are, at least have a roof over their head, have enough clothing, and so on and so forth. They have their Gucci bag they can take with them, but they are missing something in life. And somebody I talked to in my book put it well. She said, we used to think that we were unhappy because we're poor, but now many of us are not poor anymore, and we're still unhappy. And we wonder what's missing, and it's perhaps for many of them a spiritual life. And this is, you can see this angst has been going on for a while, but this lack of social trust, you can see it in these constant scandals that go viral in China, in social media, about people not helping each other on the street. Somebody just last year got knocked over. It was a woman who was crossing a pedestrian crossing, and she crossed on a red light, like people always do in China, and she sort of made it halfway, and a taxi clipped her, and she fell down in the center of the street. And then the light changed, the cars stopped, the pedestrians all went past, and everybody just looked at her and walked by. And then she's sort of lying there in the street, and then the light turned red for the pedestrians, turned green for the cars, and the cars just drive over her. And then we can just see her body. And it's horrible to see that. And it went viral again in China, because people in China, it's not just because people have some morbid, you know, fascination, but it's because it shows something, it tells Chinese people something about their society that they feel is a problem. Now, I think to some degree, these concerns are exaggerated, because I think there is a growing amount of, there are many people are are actually very helpful in China and very concerned about other people, but there is a perception that society lacks something, lacks shared values, that the traditional system, the traditional cultural system was destroyed in the tumult of the 20th century. Nobody believes in communism anymore, and the state has not offered any alternative, credible vision except for economic progress. And this was especially the case leading up to Xi Jinping's taking power in 2012. So when he took power and recognized, I think, that there was the spiritual vacuum, that there were these problems, and made restoring traditions and talking about these issues a national priority. It didn't all start directly with Xi Jinping. I think it's sometimes a mistake to see, or it's just a convenient bit of shorthand sometimes to define everything according to the rule of Chinese leaders. So Xi Jinping took power in 2012. Everything I'm talking about didn't start, boom, in 2012, in November 2012 when he took power. But he definitely ramped up efforts in this regard. Because he is a very strong, powerful leader and has made it a priority. So his anti-corruption campaign, which is often in the West is seen primarily as a political tool for whacking his opponents, which it probably is also, but it's very popular in China because people felt that corruption was out of control. And people like to see that. They also like to see the explicit support that he's given to the traditional faiths, so-called traditional faiths. By that I mean Buddhism and Taoism. I say so-called because Islam has been in China for about over 1,200 years. Christianity has had a permanent presence in China for 400 years. So these are not exactly religions that just came in last century or something like that. But the government and many Chinese people still see these as the traditional religions. Xi has increased, he's visited Confucius's hometown and said nice things about Confucius. He said very nice things about Buddhism when he went to visit the UNESCO headquarters in France. And he lauds his speeches with sort of pseudo-Confucian vocabulary. And this, I think, goes over quite well. And another innovation that he's really supported is to take many of these practices that I mentioned to you before as being superstitious. So things like fortune telling or even pilgrimages to holy mountains, things that were not supported before and were sometimes directly persecuted by the government. And redefining these practices, not as religion, but as culture. And simply saying, all of these things are traditional Chinese culture, it's okay to do that. Now, I can remember 20 years ago, 15 years ago even, up until perhaps about a decade ago, going to the Lama Temple in Beijing. That was the first slide that we saw of the crowded temple. And outside there would be fortune tellers. And every few months, the government would round up the fortune tellers and send them back to where they came from and maybe arrest some of them. Now it's completely different. If you go to the Lama Temple, all the side streets around it are full of fortune tellers. People are just renting shops, shop space. And that sort of thing is not really opposed by the government. And many things that were not encouraged or the government was maybe in a gray area where the government tolerated it, the government now is explicitly supporting. These are, for example, pilgrimages to holy mountains. My book is made up of five case studies. One of the case studies is a pilgrimage to a mountain outside of Beijing. And the government uses a term from UNESCO, the United Nations Education, Science, and Cultural Organization, called intangible cultural heritage. And it uses this term to simply redefine a lot of practices some of which were illegal in the past, and simply say it's okay now. Another group that I write about, for example, well, just that mountain outside of Beijing, the actual pilgrimage to the mountain is now considered intangible cultural heritage and gets government money. And being China, everything's extremely well organized and hierarchical, and the government has over 12,000 projects that it supports as intangible cultural heritage, from district level, city level, provincial level, national level. There are over 1,200 national level intangible cultural heritage projects, including this mountain outside of Beijing. So the government actually supports it, gives money to subsidize it. Some of the groups that make the pilgrimage up the mountain, they also get government subsidies to make the pilgrimages. So this is a complete change. If you think, it's not only extraordinary in terms of the Communist Party and its policy, but even over the past century and a half of how elites in China have seen traditional faiths, used to be seen again as a problem, and then now is something that is explicitly being co-opted, I'd say as a way to, partially as a way, for one reason is to legitimize the rule of the government. Another is because they do see that people are looking for values, they're looking for faith, and they want to provide something, realizing that communist values are not going to be attractive or credible for most people. Now, I've talked a lot about the traditional faiths, the Abrahamic faiths, Islam and Christianity. The government policy is much more ambivalent toward these two religions. Over the past decades, Christianity especially has boomed in China, especially Protestantism. Less so Catholicism, but Protestantism has increased, the number of adherents has increased rapidly. And even though about half of the Christians in China worship probably in underground or unregistered churches that are not affiliated with the government, but for the most part, the government has turned a blind eye. Now, in recent years, I think one senses a change in government policy in the past couple of years. The government is skeptical of any kind of foreign involvement of any force in society. So that includes non-governmental organizations. Foreign involvement in NGOs is not welcome at all. Some are allowed to kind of stay on because they've been there for a while. But the days when people would go over and support training of lawyers and stuff like that, those days are pretty much gone. And by the same token, in the religious sphere, the government doesn't want foreign interference in Chinese affairs. Now, the catch to that is almost all religions have some kind of a foreign component. Perhaps Taoism doesn't have too much of a foreign component, except among the Chinese diaspora. But Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, the Dalai Lama, but especially Islam, with the pilgrimage, say, to Mecca, and the global Ummah, the global body of believers, transnational ties, and Christianity as well. Catholicism, anyway, headquartered in Rome, but Protestantism also, because there are very many active evangelical movements that have close ties to China, and many Chinese Christians go abroad to study and learn. So this has become a problem for the government. It recently issued some new regulations on religious affairs to try to more tightly control religious life. They just took effect on February 1st, and I think the jury is still out about what exactly it means, because on the face of it, there are always these rules and regulations in China, but it really depends on how they're implemented, and often how they're implemented at the local level. So it's kind of early to tell. But I think overall, you have this huge, immense shift in the government's position. One way to think of it might be to think of Vladimir Putin's Russia. Putin has covered himself in the cloak of being the supporter of Russian traditions and the Orthodox Church, a defender of the faith. He even is now a believer after some sort of story I think he concocted about an automobile accident he had in the 1990s, and he changed from being an atheist KGB guy to being a believer. So it isn't exactly the same in China. Xi Jinping does not go to temples, does not worship, does not light incense. I don't believe he's a closet Buddhist, although some people think that's true. But it is true that the state is now embracing some faiths. And I think looking at the long term, looking forward, the risk that this presents is that the government is no longer a neutral arbiter in religious life in China. It's taking sides, it's supporting some faiths over others. And I think in the long run, this can have a bad effect. There's almost no interreligious dialogue in China. There's very little understanding. Faiths have very little, despite the growth of religion, they have little access to the media. There's very little discussion or interviews with religious leaders, and very little understanding of other religions. So I'm not predicting religious strife in China, but I think religion has gone from being a minor part of the Chinese story in the 20th century to being an integral part of the Chinese story in the 21st century. So I think with that, I'll stop the formal thing and open the floor to questions. Thank you.